Recorded Books presents Requiem for the Massacre, a Black history on the conflict, hope, and fallout of the 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre by R.J. Young, narrated by the author.
For my brother Ron, who never left. I would like roses to come out of the ground somewhere anytime a person's voice cracks under the weight of what it has been asked to carry. I would like to do this while the living are still the living, and I don't want to hear from any motherfucker who isn't with the program. Hanif Abdurraqib. I ain't scared of you motherfuckers. Bernie Mac. 1921 to 2020. In 1921, Ottawa W. Gurley was the richest and most powerful Black man in Tulsa. He had been among those on the starting line at the edge of Kansas and Oklahoma Territory for the land run of 1893. He was a Black man among thousands who traveled west and made stakes with their names written on them to stick into the ground and claim their parcel. He was 25 years old then, the son of two former slaves, born on Christmas Day, 1868, in Huntsville, Alabama, though he grew up in Pine Bluff, Arkansas, where he finished enough school to become a teacher and then an employee of the United States Post Office Department. He was ambitious and enterprising. Learning that the U.S. government had recently purchased 6,361,000 acres of land from the Cherokee Nation, Gurley sensed an opportunity to make his family upwardly mobile and seized it. Gurley believed what Massachusetts Senator Henry L. Dawes believed. Dawes saw the Cherokee Nation as a capitalist nightmare and a socialist utopia. Only one of those ideas has been allowed to flourish in the United States. And he was, like Gurley, determined not to let the future state of Oklahoma be an outlier. Upon returning from a visit to the Cherokee land in Indian Territory that would later become the state of Oklahoma, Dawes delivered his thoughts before a group at Lake Monhonk in New York. The head chief told us that there was not a family in that whole nation that did not have a home of its own. There was not a pauper in that nation, and the nation did not owe a dollar. It built its own capital, and it built its schools and hospitals. Yet the defect of the system was apparent. They have got as far as they can go because they own their land in common. It is Henry George's system, and under that, there is no enterprise to make your home any better than that of your neighbors. There is no selfishness, which is at the bottom of civilization. This was a philosophy Gurley believed in, too. This enterprise of taking what was once communal and sectioning it into a district powered by capitalism. For him, Dawes was prescient, not pernicious. 6 years after the formation of the Dawes Act of 1887, which led to the creation of the land runs of 1889 and 1893, Gurley, former postal worker, an employee of one of this nation's oldest institutions, wanted a parcel of this manifest destiny. On September 16, 1893, 50 miles south of the Kansas state line, Gurley drove his stake into the ground just outside what would become one of the first towns of Oklahoma. 5 days later, the town of Perry was incorporated. Gurley ran for county treasurer, though he was defeated. He became the town's school principal. As Perry expanded with cattle ranches and wheat farms, bars and restaurants opened to accommodate the growing citizenry. Gurley opened a profitable general store, yet he wanted more for his family. Wanted to continue moving up, hunting the American dream. In 1905, just outside an Oklahoma town called Tulsa, oil was discovered. The oil boom created jobs and opportunities for businessmen, including black businessmen. Black visionaries like Edward P. McCabe, Robert Reed Church, and W.E.B. Du Bois implored black folks to move from the South, where the promised Reconstruction was failing, to Oklahoma. Gurley recognized a unique opportunity in Tulsa, an all-black district on the outskirts of a town, creating oil-barren millionaires overnight. Black folks flocked to Tulsa, which citizens nicknamed Magic City. In swift order, black folks worked together to transform 40-acre lots into a city within a city, nearly 40 blocks of black-owned and black-operated businesses, from movie theaters to clothing stores, and including offices for local doctors, lawyers, and clergymen. In 1905, Gurley sold his general store and land in Perry and moved his family. He bought 40 acres just outside Tulsa, north of the train tracks that ran through the city limits. It was Gurley who opened the first grocery store in the area. In that same area, he met John the Baptist Stratford, who went by J.B. The two became friends and informal partners while building a black community on a foundation of pro-business as philosophy. But Gurley and Stratford were no fools. They knew racial animus would find them politically, socially, violently, outside of their enclave. Each sought to insulate himself, his businesses, and the growing district in an area that city architects called Greenwood. Greenwood was annexed to Tulsa in 1909 and stretched north from the Frisco Railroad tracks to Independence Avenue, east to the Midland Valley Railroad tracks, and west to Cheyenne Avenue. The Greenwood district grew faster than the city of Tulsa, outpacing the growth of Tulsa at large by 2%. In 1907, the year Oklahoma achieved statehood, 1,422 black folks lived there. By 1910, 3 years later, 2,754 black folks lived in Greenwood. By 1919, more than 10,000. The district was home to two high schools, Dunbar and Booker T. Washington, two newspapers, the Tulsa Star and the Oklahoma Sun, and three lodges, two theaters, a hospital, a library, and 13 churches. Outside the district, Tulsa lacked both job and housing opportunities for black folks. If they were fortunate to find work at all, it was as domestics and live-in servants for rich, white households. Greenwood's rapid development filled this absence, providing a pathway to wealth and stability. Journalist and publisher Andrew Jackson Smitherman wanted to see a pathway to racial equality too. Smitherman, who went by AJ, called his most famous newspaper the Tulsa Star. He was born December 27, 1883, in Childersburg, Alabama, second born of 11 children. His parents were James and Elizabeth Phillips Smitherman, and they moved the family to Indian Territory when AJ was still a boy. Smitherman's father owned a general store and coal mining outfit in Lehigh, Oklahoma. His mother was a school teacher. They were of mixed race, and they were not poor when the family moved to what would become Muskogee, Oklahoma. If not for his mother, Smitherman probably would have kept working in the mines, She sought an education for him at a time when many universities did not admit black folks. He attended the University of Kansas, Northwestern University, and the law school at LaSalle University in Philadelphia, and began his newspaper and law career in 1909. After first working in Muskogee, he accepted seed money from one of the richest men in Tulsa, J.B. Stratford, to publish the Tulsa Star. His political ideology was one of black self-reliance. He wanted black folks not to just take care of each other, but to harness their power to effect change in a country that had recognized us only as second-class citizens. In 1917, he interceded on behalf of black folks in Dewey, Oklahoma, when a mob of angry white folks burned nearly 24 black homes to the ground. Smitherman petitioned the governor on behalf of black Dewey residents and saw 36 white folks, including the mayor, arrested for the crime. At a moment when most black folks called themselves Republican, after Abraham Lincoln issued his proclamation, Smitherman announced himself as a Democrat. When President Woodrow Wilson traveled to Tulsa, Smitherman was selected as a member of the delegation to greet him. Even as he was a Democrat and a Roman Catholic, he wanted his paper to be known as politically independent. As the Star's circulation grew, so too did the respect engendered by Smitherman's name. At one point in his career, he was elected president of the Western Negro Press Association for more than a decade straight. As editor of the paper, he suffered no fools, punched up at elected officials, parried segregationist rhetoric, relentlessly campaigned against lynch law, and encouraged black folks to see not just what they'd accomplished, but that there was still more to do. Change in attitude was needed, as he would later find out. In Greenwood, a black man could be a preacher, a doctor, a businessman, a lawyer, or a teacher, but only in Greenwood. As Danny Goebel notes in Tulsa, Biography of the American City, a 1916 Tulsa ordinance forbade persons of either race from living in or maintaining a public facility in any city block in which 3/4 or more of the population was of the other race. While the U.S. Supreme Court later overturned such laws, Tulsa kept that ordinance among its statutes, codifying a segregated way of life. Meanwhile, Gurley and Stratford subdivided their land north of the railroad, creating lots for housing and retail outlets and carving out streets. On the new Greenwood Avenue, Gurley built brick boarding houses near his grocery store, as well as the African American Methodist Episcopal Church. He built apartment buildings and detached homes and the Gurley Hotel. By 1914, his net worth was estimated by the Muskogee Seminar, a nearby black-owned newspaper, at $150,000, $4.5 million in 2021. As he grew rich, so did Greenwood, which benefited from the closed-circuit nature of separate but equal. Black folks patronized each other, in part because they were socially unacceptable in Greater Tulsa. Gurley promoted this behavior, claiming to be a follower of Booker T. Washington and his philosophy of his conciliatory compromise with white folks. Many black Tulsans also followed Washington's philosophy. They left Greenwood to work as domestics, but returned home, wages in hand, to patronize businesses ran by their own. Still, Greenwood was not rich, even at its height in 1921, in comparison to St. Louis and Atlanta. But Greenwood was special because black folks could live a respectable life even without being wealthy. With the oil baron's high demand for employees, a black maid, a black chauffeur, a black bootblack, a black porter could earn enough of a living to live well. Living well meant seeing a black doctor and being respected by him. Those same professionals sent their kids to schools like Fisk, Tuskegee, Spelman, or Oberlin. Most residents of Greenwood walked through the front door of a bar, saloon, or nightclub. They paid rent to a black man, likely Gurley. In 1921, Gurley was landlord to almost half of Greenwood's residents and shopkeepers, collecting $5,000 a month in rents, $77,000 in 2021, according to Shamori Wills' Black Fortunes, the story of the first six African Americans who survived slavery and became millionaires. With more than 100 properties in Greenwood, he was worth between $500,000 and $1 million, $7.5 and $15 million in 2021. His net worth could only be guessed at in Greenwood, as Gurley kept his own money across the tracks in white banks in downtown Tulsa. His hotel, valued at least $99,000, $1.5 million in 2021, was one of the busiest in the district. In spring 1921, Gurley was symbolic of what Greenwood could be, stood for, represented, a place where a black man could rise and black folks could live good lives. Nearly all of it went up in fire and decades of institutionalized silence. Most people, black and white, were off work on Memorial Day, May 30th, 1921. But Dick Rowland, a former Booker T. Washington High School student, was at work. For him, it was just a Monday. He left Greenwood, his black enclave, to work downtown where he shined shoes on white men's feet to a high buff. But even he had to use the bathroom. Tulsa was segregated. There was no restroom nearby where he worked that black Tulsans were allowed to use. This is the most reasonable rationale for why he entered the Drexel Building, located at 319 South Main Street, a block away from a white storefront. The restroom was on the Drexel's top floor. To get there, Rowland had to use the elevator in the back of the building, which was operated by a 17-year-old white girl named Sarah Page. Did she know him? Almost certainly, yes. She would have recognized all the shoe shiners who needed to use the restroom. She ferried Rowland to the fourth floor and back down again. Then someone, who remains unnamed to this day, heard this white girl scream and saw this black boy running away. And someone, perhaps the same unnamed someone, called police. A white shop clerk at Renberg's, a high-end clothing store on the ground level of the Drexel, swore he knew what happened, though he said he did not witness what he later said must have happened. Based on this hearsay, two Tulsa police officers showed up to Dick's mama's house on the morning of May 31st. They told Damie Rowland they needed to arrest her son, which they did. Later, no one would much care that Paige refused to press charges or that Dick was exonerated, which begs the question, was white mob violence in Greenwood about a black boy and a white girl at all? What happened inside the elevator isn't known. When the elevator opened, Paige screamed. It was assumed by a white man who heard the scream, and white folks who heard this white man claim he heard her scream, and saw Roland run away, that he had attacked her, attempted to rape her, and then had run down Archer Street back to Greenwood. Whether Roland and Paige were romantically entangled is unclear, but sexual assault was alleged and a police report was filed. A black man sexually assaulting a white woman was news enough to merit an article in one of the city's two white-owned newspapers, the Tulsa Tribune. The Tribune's May 31 story about Roland's alleged assault of Paige was five paragraphs long. Headline, Nab Negro Attacking Girl in Elevator. The initial police report didn't mention Paige by name. Roland was arrested the same morning the Tribune published its account. The following day, Roland was taken into custody. He was jailed at the police station at 109 East 2nd Street, where he admitted to stepping on Paige's foot. The Tulsa World, the other white-owned newspaper in the city, ran a story about Roland's arrest in its June 1 edition. There was movement afoot, it was reported, among white people to go to the county courthouse Tuesday night and lynch the bootblack. Tulsa Police Commissioner James Atkinson answered an anonymous phone call the day Roland was arrested. "We're going to lynch that Negro tonight," the caller told him. Atkinson said the threat was credible enough that he asked Tulsa Police Chief John Gustafson to move Roland to the Tulsa County Jail because the city jail was much easier to break into than the county one. That also meant Roland legally changed hands from the city police to the Tulsa County Sheriff's Office. Roland was turned over to Tulsa Sheriff Bill McCullough, who called on his deputies to fortify the jail on the fifth floor of the county courthouse. As news of Roland's arrest spread, black and white Tulsans organized and gathered outside the courthouse where Roland was now being held. They formed two segregated groups. Black men, some with guns, stood outside to defend Roland, while white men sought to disarm their black counterparts. Many of these men, both white and black, were veterans of World War I. Upon finding out Roland was in jail, and there was a rumor of white folks looking to lynch him just before 7 p.m. on June 1st, a black veteran taking in a show at the Dreamland Theater, a space that seated up to 750, leaped up. "We're not going to let this happen," he said. "We're going to go downtown and stop this lynching, close this place down." C.F. Gabe, a black man, said he was first apprised that white folks were going to lynch Roland while he was on his way to see friends around 6:30 p.m. on May 31st. He lived in Greenwood for 15 years. When he heard about Roland, he said he went home and pulled off his gun, heading to the courthouse later that evening. He saw Deputy Barney Cleaver, O.W. Gurley, and 700 to 800 people outside the building. A white person whom Gabe couldn't identify told him to get these niggers away from here, noting tension was building. Not long after, he saw a carload of white men drive up to the courthouse. "Let's go to the armory," he heard one of them say. When another white person pointed a gun at him, Gabe decided to go back to Greenwood. Coming to the intersection of Boston and Archer, he found a frenzied group of what he estimated was about 5,000 black folks. Here, he turned around yet again and made for the courthouse, then decided to leave the courthouse once more, perhaps feeling boxed in. He walked 4 blocks and heard gunfire. He turned around one last time to head to the courthouse again, but was stopped by Police Commissioner Atkinson, who told him to leave the area or risk getting hurt. He encountered Deputy Sheriff John Smitherman shortly thereafter. Gabe said Smitherman asked for assistance to help stop the thing. Gabe thought perhaps J.B. Stratford could help. He walked to Stratford's hotel to ask him to use his influence to end the conflict, but Stratford refused to help him. Gabe left Stratford and walked to Cincinnati and Archer by himself. There, he saw 2 white men shot while attempting to set fire to a house. A 3rd white man accomplished what the 1st 2 had attempted. Upon seeing the house ablaze, Gabe made his way back to his home at 422 East Easton Street and went to sleep. Greenwood, however, began to burn. At 7 p.m., Sheriff McCullough was joined by the only black deputy in Greenwood, Barney Cleaver, and implored both blacks and whites to go back home. Cleaver was 54 in 1921 and was the first black member of both the Tulsa Police Department and the Tulsa County Sheriff's Office. He tried to assure his black neighbors that no harm would come to Roland and went inside the jail to be sure. In August 1920, 18-year-old Roy Belton had been ripped from jail and lynched by white Tulsans after pleading not guilty to the murder of Homer Nida. Police Chief Gustafson and his officers had arrived in time to stop the lynching, but he had ordered his men not to intervene, telling the world any demonstration from an officer would have started gunplay and dozens of innocent people would have been killed and injured. The black men of Tulsa resolved not to leave Roland's life in the hands of police. Their number outside the courthouse only grew between 7 and 9 p.m. In her book, Race Riot 1921, Events of the Tulsa Disaster, Mary Elizabeth Jones Parrish, a secretarial teacher, recounted what she saw outside the courthouse as she led out her class around 9 p.m. on May 31st. I am told this little bunch of brave and loyal black men who were willing to give up their lives if necessary for the sake of a fellow man marched up to the jail where there were already 500 white men gathered, and that this number was soon swelled to 1,000. The Oklahoma National Guard was under the command of Adjutant General Charles Barrett. 3 National Guard units, a rifle company, a supply company, and a sanitary unit, were stationed in Tulsa in 1921. Colonel L.J.F. Rooney was the senior National Guard officer in Tulsa. National Guard Major Charles Daly was first made aware of the crowd at the courthouse at 8:30 p.m. Barrett told Rooney to make his troops available to local police if need be. In theory, Major Daly had several hundred veterans and servicemen at his disposal across Tulsa and the neighboring towns, Bristow, Broken Arrow, and Cleveland. Crucially, guardsmen wore a khaki uniform. As news spread about the crowd outside the courthouse, William Redfern, a white man who owned 2 buildings in Greenwood, closed his Dixie Theater, a space that seated more than 1,000, at 9:30 p.m. He took it upon himself to find out what was going on at the courthouse, said he saw nearly 60 people turning violent, and turned around to go back to his theater, where he claimed he was going to try to prevent more from coming to the courthouse. National Guard Captain Van Voorhis was at the armory when local police called and asked for assistance. He called Colonel Rooney at 9:30 p.m. After an attempt by three white men to take Roland from the sheriff's custody, the sheriff decided to barricade the jail. He locked Roland, his men, and himself in his office. As a small number of white men pushed their way into the courthouse interior, a white man named E.S. McQueen tried to disarm a black man identified as Johnny Cole. McQueen grabbed Cole's gun. Cole refused to let go, and the gun fired. The June 1st edition of The World reported that 150 white men and 300 black men were at the courthouse at 10:15 p.m. on May 31st when fighting and shooting began in earnest, and the number of white men joining in was still growing as black men at the courthouse had begun to fight back. Tulsa police officer J.L. Wilson told The World that a group of black men threatened to lynch him at 2nd Street in Cincinnati, but he was let go when a black man talked them down. National Guard Major Byron Kirkpatrick saw armed men in cars speeding past his house on 6th Street, then heard gunfire at 5th and Elgin and called Rooney. Rooney and Voorhis met at Kirkpatrick's home, where Rooney called Barrett in Oklahoma City at 10:13 p.m. and told him about the violence taking place. Barrett told them to guard the armory and assist local authorities, but that no one could mobilize without the governor's approval. After the phone call, Rooney told Voorhis to take 16 men to the police station. Barrett called and got through to Oklahoma Governor James B.A. Robertson shortly thereafter. He telephoned Chief Gustafson and asked if he needed assistance from the guard. Gustafson told Governor Robertson no help was needed. Between 1,500 and 2,000 white folks had convened outside the courthouse by 10:30 p.m. Governor Robertson, however, felt that more action was needed, and since the Tulsa authorities were apparently content with matters as they stood, he took the initiative. According to Scott Ellsworth's Death in a Promised Land, the Tulsa Race Riot of 1921. Shortly after midnight, he ordered Major Kirkpatrick in Tulsa to draw up a telegram addressed to the governor, requesting that the National Guard be sent into the city. He then ordered Kirkpatrick to get Gustafson, McCullough, and any district judge he could find to sign it, since at that time, Oklahoma law required that a request for the National Guard to be sent into any area needed the signatures of the local police chief, the county sheriff, and a local judge. Kirkpatrick completed his task hours later. While he tracked down signatures, black families fought or fled. Kenny Booker was 8 years old, one of five children, living at 320 North Hartford Avenue. We had a lovely home, filled with beautiful furniture, including a grand piano, he told the Greenwood Cultural Center. All our clothes and personal belongings, just everything, were burned up during the riot. Early on the morning of June 1, 1921, my parents were awakened by the sounds of shooting and the smell of fire and the noise of fleeing blacks running past our house. My dad awakened us children and sent us to the attic with our mother. We could hear what was going on below. We heard the white men ordering Dad to come with them. He was being taken to detention. We could hear Dad pleading with the mobsters. He was begging them, "Please don't set my house on fire." But of course, that is exactly what they did just before they left with Dad. Though Dad went outside the house with the mobsters, he slipped away from them when they got preoccupied, splashing gasoline or kerosene on the outside of the house to speed up the burning. He rushed to the attic and rescued us. We slipped into the crowd of fleeing black refugees. Thank God we did not burn up in that attic. Otis Clark was 19, like Roland, and was trying to find a way out of the carnage with a friend. "I got caught right in the middle of that riot," he told the Cultural Center. "Some white mobsters were holed up in the upper floor of the Ray Ree Flour Mill on East Archer, and they were just gunning down black people, just picking them off like they were swatting flies. Well, I had a friend who worked for Jackson's funeral home, and he was trying to get to that new ambulance so he could drive it to safety. I went with him. He had the keys in his hands, ready for the takeoff. But one of the mobsters in the rebuilding zoomed in on him and shot him in the hand. The keys flew to the ground, and blood shot out of his hand, and some of it sprayed on me. We both immediately abandoned plans to save that ambulance. We ran for our lives. We never saw my stepfather again, nor our little pet bulldog, Bob. I just know they perished in that riot. My stepfather was a strong family man. I know he did not desert us. I just wish I knew where he was buried." The governor's order to mobilize the guard in Oklahoma City to Tulsa came at 3 a.m. on June 1st. But the National Guard in Tulsa had already arrived at the police station at 11 p.m. on May 31st. The guard received reports that white men had broken into McGee's hardware store and stolen guns and ammo. The store owner later said he thought Tulsa Police Captain George H. Blaine was the leader of the group who robbed his store. Bula Lane Keenan Smith had just celebrated her 13th birthday when white men destroyed her family's home. Mobsters had kicked a hole in the side of the store and had set it on fire. "That was the saddest day of my life. That riot cheated us out of childhood innocence." Delois Vaden Ramsey was a toddler during the massacre. She was born in March 1919. My father, Hosea Oscar Vaden, owned one of the most popular pool halls in Tulsa at the time of the Tulsa riot, she told the Cultural Center. Vaden's pool hall was located on Greenwood Avenue next to Arch Chili Parlor. Across the street was another pool hall, Spann's Pool Hall. Younger people went to Spann's, and older people came to Dad's pool hall. Famous people were always coming to play pool at Vaden's pool hall. Boxer Joe Lewis always came by my dad's pool hall to buy newspapers. Dad sold black Dispatch newspapers and white Tulsa newspapers. My parents also owned a home on Elgin Street, which burned to the ground in the riot. I was too young to personally remember details of the riot, but I heard my parents talk about the riot, how bad it was, how it destroyed so much property that blacks had worked so hard to acquire. Past midnight and before 2 a.m., a group of white Tulsans smashed the front windows of a pair of businesses and set the insides afire on Archer Street in the southwestern corner of Greenwood. Firefighters at fire station number 2 answered the call to extinguish the flames. They were stopped before putting their hoses into action by the same group of white men who set the fire. They wanted to see the building burn. Farther north in deep green wood, white Tulsans snuck across the Santa Fe and Frisco railroad tracks. They shot out the Williams building and the office of the Oklahoma Sun, one of two black newspapers that would be forced to shutter due to the damage and denial of insurance claims. The other, the Tulsa Star, was decimated along with A.J. Smitherman's livelihood. 9 p.m., the trouble started, he later wrote. 2 a.m., the thing was done. Mary Elizabeth Jones Parrish was wide awake, clutching her child in her apartment as the fighting began to leak into Greenwood past midnight. About 1:30 o'clock, the firing had somewhat subsided, and it was hoped that the crisis was over, she wrote. Someone on the street cried out, "Look, they are burning Cincinnati." On looking, we beheld columns of smoke and fire. And by this, we knew the enemy was surging quickly upon Greenwood. She watched as black men stood and defended their community, defended her, from white men shooting, setting fire to the place they called home. "Our boys stood like a stone wall," she wrote, offsetting each and every attempt to burn Greenwood and the immediate vicinity. White men coming in behind those pierced through to the Frisco railroad tracks punctured at least one passenger train and set fires at the southwestern boundary of Greenwood. At 3:15 a.m., Major Daly said he saw to it fires were extinguished at the Boston and Frisco railroad tracks. But right afterward, he said in his report, 5 weeks after the massacre, he saw white men climb onto platforms at the Frisco Depot on the track's south side. "I immediately went to the depot and found a large crowd gathered on the platform of the Frisco station, also on the Frisco tracks, where several of the men were firing over into the black belt." He said he organized 20 volunteer guardsmen with rifles to stop white attackers further firing into the Negro district. Gunfire was exchanged across the street from Booker T. Washington High School and a brickyard off Lansing Avenue and at Pine Street and Peoria Avenue. Another firefight took place at Mount Zion Baptist Church. As black folks defended their place of worship, the all-white National Guard arrived on scene and pointed their machine guns at the church. The church's stained glass windows were shattered, and the church was filled with holes. Suddenly, the church erupted in sound and flames, ensuring the desolation of a house of worship with the help of the military on American soil. No black Tulsan attended church that Sunday. White Tulsans had burned them down. Mabel Little, 25, who owned an eatery called the Little Cafe on East Cameron, later wrote, "Airplanes dropped incendiary bombs to enhance the burning of Mount Zion Baptist Church and business buildings." W.I. Brown was a porter on a train taking the Katy Railroad and arriving in Tulsa on June 1st. "Two airplanes were doing the most work," he said. "They would every few seconds drop something, and every time they did, there was a loud explosion, and the sky would be filled with flying debris." B.C. Franklin, an attorney who had just moved to Tulsa, recounted seeing men urging one another to set fires in parts of White Tulsa in the throes of the massacre. James Layton Avery, a teenager then, said decades later, "There was a mob of black and white men in confrontation, lots of yelling, screams, and women, and the firing of many guns. Cars sped by haphazardly, and no policing of the streets could be seen." By 4 a.m. on June 1, Dick Rowland was the safest black man in Tulsa. When the mob that initially set out to take Rowland turned its attention to Greenwood, Rowland was all but forgotten by nearly every white man, except those charged with protecting him. From the fifth floor of his barricaded jail and office, Sheriff McCullough believed the situation was well under control when a reporter from the World made his way up to the jail in the middle of the night. "We believe we have the situation well in hand without further help from the National Guard or state militia," he said. "While I do not feel the situation warrants help from the outside, yet it is always best to place safety first." After finding out Rowland was secure in the courthouse, Deputy Barney Cleaver walked toward home in North Greenwood to get his family and take them to a farmhouse he owned outside the city limits. He saw armed black and white groups, hostile and prowling. He was joined by two other black men on his way. The trio were stopped by carloads of white men, asking who they were and where they were coming from. Once back in Greenwood, Cleaver happened upon 15 or 20 boys with guns, asking if Rowland had been lynched. Cleaver told them no. Rowland had not been lynched. He asked them to go home. They waved him off. "White man lover," one of them called him. All night, black folks stood ready to fight. Some stood in their own front yards with guns, preparing for the attack they knew was coming to their homes. At a building Cleaver owned, some black folks had climbed to the second floor, overlooking the intersection at Easton and Greenwood. Cleaver said he joined them and waited until nearly 5 a.m. Then they heard a shrill whistle. The high pitch of the whistle woke C.F. Gabe from his sleep, a carpenter at Dreamland Theater. Green Smith said he heard a siren blare as he was installing a cooling system and went to the window to peer around after hearing the whistle. James T.A. West told Parrish he heard the whistle too, while staying with Booker T. Washington High School principal Ellis Walker Woods at his home on Detroit Avenue. "About 5 o'clock, a very peculiar whistle blew," he said. "This seemed to be a signal for a concerted attack by the whites, for immediately a terrible gunfire began. Airplanes also began to fly over very low. What they were doing, I cannot say, for I was in my room." Dr. R.T. Bridgewater heard the whistle while he, his wife, Maddie, and their niece left their house. He'd received a phone call just minutes earlier imploring him to attend to two wounded men. As he opened the front door, a bullet hit his leg. He fled back inside his home. His wife stuck her head out front door and fled back inside as bullets hit the door. They escaped out the back. "Shortly after, we left, a whistle blew," Bridgewater said. "Some black folks did not hear the whistle. Some white folks have said the noise came from a steel plant near Greenwood. Others have said the noise came from the first steam whistle at the Public Service Oklahoma plant installed in November 1920. The World reported the PSO whistle could be heard within a 20-mile radius and was used when announcing changes of shift, election returns, and other news of public interest. Not everyone in Greenwood heard or mentioned hearing the whistle, but the people who did thought what West and Bridgewater did. The shots rang from a machine gun located on Standpipe Hill near my residence, and airplanes began to fly over us, in some instances, very low to the ground, Bridgewater said. A cry was heard from the women saying, "Look out for the airplanes. They are shooting upon us." There was a great shadow in the sky, Parrish wrote, and upon second look, we discerned that this cloud was caused by fast-approaching airplanes. It then dawned upon us that the enemy had organized in the night and was invading our district, the same as the Germans invaded France and Belgium. The terror continued from the ground into the early morning. Parrish, watching from her apartment in the Woods building, Greenwood and Archer, saw carloads of men with rifles unloading up near the granary, which is located on the railroad tracks near First Street. Then the truth dawned upon us that our men were fighting in vain to hold their dear Greenwood. About 5:30, someone called up our home and said for the men not to fight, West told Parrish, that the home guard were visiting the homes and searching them, but that they would harm no one. A few minutes after that, some men appeared with guns drawn and ordered all men out of the house. West was made to raise his hands, searched, and then put into line with other black men on the street. In all, he said, 30 to 40 men were rounded up and marched through the street to the convention hall, while some ruffians would shoot at our heels and swore at those who had difficulty keeping up. Greensmith watched a gang knocking on the doors and setting the buildings on fire. Who were the men in these gangs? Policemen, I guess, he said. He was harassed by 10 or 12. They wore what they call special police and deputy sheriff's badges. Some had ribbons, and some of them had regular stars. Gurley's hotel was raided by men wearing khaki suits. They were clear in their warning to him. You better get out of that hotel, because we're going to burn all of this goddamn stuff. Upon leaving, Gurley was met with a hail of gunfire sprayed down Greenwood Avenue. He took shelter at Dunbar School on North Hartford Avenue, but was forced to leave that place, too, after it was set ablaze. Ernestine Gibbs was 18 in 1921. A family friend fled to her house after the fighting broke out. He was so scared he could not sit still or lie down. He just paced up and down the floor, talking about the mess going on downtown and on Greenwood. When daylight came, black people were moving down the train tracks like ants. We joined the fleeing people. During this fleeing frenzy, we made it to Golden Gate Park near 36th Street North. We had to run from there because someone warned us that whites were shooting down blacks who were fleeing along railroad tracks. Some of them were shot by whites firing from airplanes. Survivors said they saw turpentine bombs drop from the airplanes onto Greenwood, likely used to control the flames so that the fire did not escape the district and threaten Greater Tulsa. A train pulling into Union Station was shot up as Tulsa's fire department put out only those fires that threatened white businesses downtown. Near 8 a.m. on June 1st, Dr. A.C. Jackson, a person the Mayo Clinic founders called the most able Negro surgeon in America, according to the Greenwood Cultural Center, was one of those who surrendered at gunpoint. With his hands in the air, a group of white men shot him as he was headed into an internment camp. I heard him holler and looked up and saw him coming about 20 feet away from me, or 30, with his hands up, and he said, "Here I am. I want to go with you," or words to that effect, Jackson's white neighbor and former police commissioner John Oliphant said in his testimony. I said to the fellows, "That's Dr. Jackson. Don't hurt him." Oliphant, who lived just around the corner, thought he could get the police to stop these 7 or 8 fellows from killing Dr. Jackson. Oliphant never identified Jackson's murderers, and they were never caught. Oliphant said he was trying to stop arsonists from torching his home rather than just trying to save Dr. Jackson's life. I wanted to get some policemen to help me. I thought I could stop that whole business, but I guess I was mistaken. Near mid-morning, Oliphant thought the violence had finished. The fight was all over and had been for an hour and a half. There was no shooting at that particular time because there were no Negroes to shoot at. The two men who shot Dr. Jackson were dressed as civilians, but Oliphant said several more wore khaki uniforms. Looters arrived at the property quickly and in force. Oliphant said they were 100 or 2 in number, men, women, and children. Some were singing, some were playing pianos that were taken out of the buildings. Some were running Victrolas, some dancing a jig, and just having a rollicking, easy good time in a business which they thought was upright. Oliphant went on. They absolutely sacked all the houses and took everything out. Pianos, Victrolas, clothing, chairs, musical instruments, clothing of all kinds, men, women, and children would go in the house and fill up pillowcases, sheets, and clothing, and carry them out and carry them away. Guy Ashby was a young white clerk at Cooper's Grocery Store on 14th Street. When he showed up to work on June 1st, his boss told him to go back home. "The boss told me there would be no work today, as he was declaring it Nigger Day, and he was going hunting niggers," Ashby said. "He took a rifle and told me to lock up the store." A gang of white Tulsans went to the home of an old couple, and the old man, 80 years old, was paralyzed, sat in a chair, and they told him to march, and he told them he was crippled, but he'd go if someone would take him, and they told his wife old too, to go, but she didn't want to leave him. And he told her to go on anyway, a person told the Chicago Defender for a story appearing less than 2 weeks after the massacre. As she left, one of the damn dogs shot the old man. White Tolson's burned down Frizzle Memorial Hospital and the Colored Library branch at 429 East Archer. White Tolson's took books from the library and burned them in the street. There are many substantial but anonymous eyewitness accounts. These accounts are nearly impossible to verify using empirical means, but I have little doubt that most, if not all, are true. White Tulsa women looted black homes with shopping bags in hand, shoving silverware, clothing, and jewelry into those bags while remarking how much better black Tulsans lived than they did. White Tulsans swept through recently abandoned homes, loaded black Tulsans' furniture into trucks, and threw black family Bibles into flames. White Tulsans snapped photos in front of black-owned ruins. Gangs of white Tulsa men cornered black couples and black families, killed black fathers and husbands, separated black wives and mothers from their children, and raped them behind a brick wall just close enough so that those children could hear their mothers' violent screams. Governor Robertson declared martial law in Tulsa at 11:29 a.m. on June 1st, leaving the National Guard's Charles Barrett in charge. One of Barrett's most consequential acts as officer in charge was banning funerals. His next was interning black Tulsans at the convention hall, baseball park, and fairgrounds. Nearly all black Tulsans who were held captive needed a white person to vouch for them to gain release. Some wouldn't gain release for a week. Some black Tulsans managed to escape involuntary imprisonment by hiding in the woods on the outskirts of town or disappearing into the woods altogether. By noon on June 1st, the fighting had ended. All but just a few Greenwood residents had been taken into custody and interned. The National Guard, with more forces from Oklahoma City, patrolled the edge of the district. Greenwood was in ashes, piles of bricks where 600 businesses, 1,200 buildings, and 36 blocks, home to 10,000 people, used to be. Greenwood Avenue, principal business district in the Negro District, is a mass of broken bricks and debris, the World reported the following day. Only gas and water pipes, bath fixtures, bedsteads, or other metal fixtures remain to mark the places where homes once stood. The Negro residences remaining intact can almost be counted on one's hand. There is not an undamaged business building owned by Negroes in the entire district. I watched this awful destruction from where I sat on the hillside, said an unidentified person in Parrish's book, later believed to be Mrs. C. L. Netherland. As I sat and watched my modern tin-room and basement home burn to ashes, an old white man came by. Addressing me as Auntie, he said, "It's awful, ain't it?" and offered me a dollar to buy my dinner with. With the district bathed in black smoke fires still smoldering. Barrett's 7 companies of guardsmen, having already rounded up thousands of Black Tulsans and interned them at the county fairgrounds, awaited further instruction. At 8:30 a.m. on June 2nd, the situation was well under control, Barrett declared to the world. We do not anticipate any further rioting, although nothing has been overlooked as a precaution against its recurrence. With Tulsa under martial law, which is now in force, we expect to see rapid readjustment of conditions. Nearly the entire population of Black Tulsans who had not been killed or escaped had been detained at the fairgrounds. Less than a month after the massacre, an all-white grand jury had been assembled and submitted its findings. We find that the recent race riot was the direct result of an effort on the part of a certain group of colored men who appeared at the courthouse on the night of May 31st, 1921. It further stated, there was no mob spirit among the whites, no talk of lynching, and no arms. Neither the World nor the Tribune acknowledged the massacre or its anniversary for 30 years. At Tribune, Ellsworth wrote in his 1992 book-length account, Death in a Promised Land, someone removed a front-page article and part of an editorial page from the May 31st, 1921 edition in the bound volumes of the newspaper before they were microfilmed by the Works Progress Administration in the 1930s. The Oklahoma Eagle, a Black newspaper that picked up the spiritual mantle left after the demolition of the Star and Sun, made its first reference to the massacre in 1946. In 1921, racial bitterness, which had been brooding for several years, culminated in one of the most disastrous race riots in the nation's history. Also in 1946, Lauren Gill published a detailed account, The Massacre, for his master's thesis. Gill's work, called The Tulsa Race Riot, is notable because, as Dr. Rachel Hill pointed out in her work, The 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre, Gill's thesis is an unusual inquiry into an event that was largely censored. While Gill gave an account of the white mob-led violence against Greenwood in a way that certainly represented a more balanced view than the blatantly prejudiced and sensational 1921 newspaper articles, he affirmed the Tulsa grand jury's report's assessment that armed African Americans were a principal cause. In 1948, Nancy Feldman, a sociology instructor at the University of Tulsa, met Robert Fairchild, a Black Tulsan in his 50s, while working on behalf of the League of Women Voters in Tulsa. She was attempting to find a doctor for Tulsa's county health department when she met Fairchild, a recreation officer who studied at the University of Nebraska and held a master's in public health. Born in Arkansas and raised in Tulsa, he was the first person to tell Feldman about what was then called the Tulsa Race Riot. It happened when he was 17, and he survived it. Being from Chicago, Feldman was so fascinated by this history she'd never heard before that she brought a conversation about the riot to a class she taught at TU. She was surprised to learn her students had never heard of the event. When she asked their parents and other older adults, she knew. Some said They had no idea the riot happened, and others denied that the riot had occurred. So she brought Fairchild in to talk to her class, and he told her students about the carnage wrought beginning that Memorial Day in 1921. He told them about walking on the railroad tracks alongside his brother to escape being killed. In an oral history Feldman gave for Voices of Oklahoma with John Erling in 2012, she said a TU dean of students called her into his office and told her not to let Fairchild speak to her class again. John Erling asked, why did the dean not want Mr. Fairchild to speak? He didn't want to create any troubles, Feldman said. In fewer than 30 years, the massacre had been erased from the memory of white Tulsans, as white folks were the only people Feldman taught at TU, a university that had not integrated and would later become my alma mater. Nearly 100 years later, I stood on one of the plaques embedded in the sidewalk on Greenwood Avenue. Some brick buildings survived next to an urban renewal that threatens to engulf what the flames did not claim in the district. The Oklahoma Eagle office was just behind me. The Black Wall Street Gallery was just ahead of me, though it, like most good things in Tulsa, has left us too, now that the gallery is in New York City. As I walked the sidewalk, stepping from plaque to plaque, I saw one that honors Bayer Grocery at 304 North Frankfort Avenue, and another for Dr. P.I. Travis at 122 North Greenwood Avenue. There are dozens of them, several for doctors, alongside the Dreamland Theater, once at 127 North Greenwood Avenue, and Duncan and Clinton Grocers at 123 North Greenwood. There is a plaque for A.J. Smitherman's offices at 115 North Greenwood, and one for Commodore's, Knott's, Cotton Club at 232A North Greenwood. There are plaques for tailors and clothing stores, restaurants, a barbershop, a printing shop, a shoe store, a cigar store, a bakery, real estate offices, hotels, and a hospital. Greenwood was so much bigger, so much brighter than this block that's slowly being squeezed, pushed, and priced out. On May 29th, 1921, this space was a vibrant and exploding city within the city of Tulsa. It was a prosperous community for Black folks looking to escape the racist values, the American values, that had plagued them for so long. For about 20 years, this place offered them hope, community, and respite. A mob of white Tulsans burned Greenwood to the ground, which led to the deaths of 39 people, according to the 1921 Tulsa Race Riot Commission. 26 of them were Black. 13 of them were white. All 39 are listed as male. It should be added, however, said the final report of the Oklahoma Commission to study the Tulsa Race Riot of 1921, that at least one credible source from the period, Maurice Willows, who directed the relief operations of the American Red Cross in Tulsa following the riot, indicated in his official report that the total number of riot fatalities may have run as high as 300. The bodies of black Tulsans were piled onto flatbed trucks. Some were buried without a monument to mark them. Still more were buried in unmarked mass graves. According to some accounts, bodies were dumped into the Arkansas River. The Oakland Cemetery in South Downtown was said to hold mass graves, as was New Block Park in West Downtown. When families went to claim life insurance policies, most were denied. An article in the June 5, 1921 edition of the Columbus Dispatch noted that former Tulsa Mayor L.J. Martin chaired a committee established by the Tulsa Chamber of Commerce to investigate black Tulsans' claims to reparations since the insurance companies denied their claims. Most of this damage was done by white criminals who should have been shot and killed. As the final outcome, we must rebuild these houses, see that the Negroes get their insurance, and get their claims against the city and county. The committee followed with a suggestion of $500,000 to pay black Tulsans for property loss. Tulsa Mayor T.D. Evans held fast to his claims that black Tulsans had caused the massacre, and the committee was forced to announce the city would not financially recompense its black citizens. Martin and the committee members tendered their resignations on July 15th. They were replaced by a new committee created by the city commission. O.W. Gurley lost more than $250,000 in the massacre, over $3.8 million in 2021 dollars. Months afterward, he moved to Los Angeles, bought a four-bedroom home, and opened another hotel. He eventually sold his land in Greenwood to other black folks who stayed. Mayor Evans and the city commission pressured black residents to sell their land so that the city of Tulsa could redistrict Greenwood for industrial use. In a meeting with members of the city commission, Evans wrote, "Let the Negro settlement be placed farther to the north and east." The nation called this Tulsa's shame. Gurley, Cleaver, Green, and Gabe were a few who testified in a lawsuit brought by William Redfern, the owner of the Dixie Theater, against the American Central Insurance Company. The Oklahoma Supreme Court ruled for the insurance company on January 12, 1926, which extinguished Greenwood property owners' best chance for restitution. To make even more money from the carnage, photos of the damage were turned into postcards with captions like "Little Africa on Fire" and "Running the Negro Out of Tulsa." The exact number of people killed during the massacre remains unknown, with the best educated guesses numbering in the hundreds and damages approaching millions of dollars. Complicating the idea of the massacre is still the thought that it was a premeditated, conspired real estate scheme and not just a hate crime. The difference between attempted genocide and chaotic violence is the difference between riot and massacre. A riot implies that black Tulsans destroyed our own community. A massacre implies a brutal and deliberate slaughter of one group of people perpetrated by another group. It took only 24 hours for white Tulsans to decimate 36 city blocks and burn down more than 1,200 homes of beautiful blackness. The American Red Cross estimated white Tulsans took hundreds of black lives they decided did not matter. Some scholars estimate the number of black lives lost is higher, so much higher, in fact, that an earnest search for mass graves filled with black bodies began 99 years later. Damage to property and generational wealth is estimated in the tens of millions of dollars by 21st century standards. Statutes of limitations have mostly put a stop to justice for the black lives and black property lost in American court systems, though a few are still trying to force the state to financially atone for his barbarism. Institutional racism and housing discrimination have made certain that black Tulsans mostly live in the section of the city known as North Tulsa, and only in North Tulsa. North Tulsa provides fewer job and enrichment opportunities and a worse standard of living than its white counterpart, South Tulsa. Human Rights Watch recognized the damage done in a massive report in May 2020. Under international human rights law, governments have an obligation to provide effective remedies for violations of human rights. The fact that a government abdicated its responsibility nearly 100 years ago and continued to do so in subsequent years does not absolve it of that responsibility today, especially when failure to address the harm and related action and inaction result in further harm, as it has in Tulsa. Human Rights Watch supports the conclusion of the Oklahoma Commission to Study the Tulsa Race Riot of 1921, recently renamed the Tulsa Race Massacre Commission, a commission created by the Oklahoma State Legislature in 1997 to study the massacre and make recommendations that reparations should be made. I was 10 years old in 1997. My parents were reaching for the American dream they had been promised. We were living in Hattiesburg, Mississippi, when a moving truck emerged at the dead end of our block in front of the first house I have memory of at 800 Maple Street. My younger sister, Denise, who we all call Niece, and I never knew life without having our own rooms. We were so indulged in our individuality that we took to the idea of a bunk bed because we thought that might be fun. I slept on the top bunk and Niece slept on the bottom for just a couple of weeks before she decided she'd made a mistake. I moved to the bottom. The movers had no trouble taking down the bed, packing its fire truck red railing and two twin mattresses into what I believed was the largest trailer in the world, for it held my entire life and that of my family. When the movers hoisted our velvet red couch and then our matching sofa, I scurried outside to stand in the street. I couldn't believe one would fit, let alone both. When I saw not only did they fit, but there was ample room to spare, I thought the world was surely too big, never that my view of it was too small. I was born on Tinker Air Force Base in Oklahoma City, in Okie by birth. My mother, Felicia, was a captain in the United States Air Force and my father was a buck sergeant when they met. Mama gave birth to me just before leaving the military, and my father finished his service just as Niece was brought into this world 23 months later. Having enlisted as soon as he graduated high school in Graceville, Florida, my father's plan, a decade later, was to go to college at Southern Miss and open a computer repair business while he pursued his degree. He wanted to move closer to his home, a small town outside of Graceville called Campbellton, but my mother had implored my father to move us all to Hattiesburg, to her hometown, so that her mother, my grandmommy, could help raise us. I couldn't have known then that both of my parents would get what they wanted. I have little recollection of the drive from Oklahoma City to Hattiesburg, only that my mother found the whole ordeal harrowing. They'd packed themselves, loaded their home into a U-Haul, put my sister and me in the back of their car, and departed. Mama drove the car with my sister and me strapped into car seats in the back. My father followed in the U-Haul. I don't remember arriving at the house. I don't remember what the house looked like without furnishings. I only remember my red bike with training wheels in the driveway of the carport. I was happy. The first school I was ever enrolled in was Jefferson Davis Head Start. My first teacher, Mrs. Moore, greeted me and my four-year-old classmates, all of whom were black, with the most perfect welcome I've ever heard for a preschool class. After the last parent had left on the first day of school, she shut the door, lifted her nose, quickly looked down it in one motion, and said, "I'm your mama now." I was shook. When I told my mother this story later, she smiled at me. "You'll be all right," she said. Mama had chosen Mrs. Moore for me and later my sister because Mrs. Moore was a strict disciplinarian. Mama was always at Head Start or downtown at the local Head Start headquarters. She split her time between pursuing a terminal master's degree in marriage and family therapy at Southern Miss, where she'd also earned her undergraduate degree in special education nearly 20 years prior while participating in the USM Reserve Officers Training Corps.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.